Good evening. I have been writing a novel for the last 2.5 years. I completed my research from 2015 to around about last summer. Then I had a break from it, and I continued my research in the interim period. I've amassed a huge amount of research and notes, and I've just buckled down for the spring now here in Sweden to actually finish this novel, which is called Conquest of Doe, and then go back and finish my first novel, which is actually called The Plantsman. This novel, I just read what it's about here. Or the blurb that I put on the website about it anyway. This is the website, Conquest of Doe. It's a multimedia website, and it's got tabs you can navigate on the top, and then you just scroll down through so you can see. This is the logo of another book I found on the web, which I haven't found that has been published, but I do hope it does get published. It was a very interesting read and had some really excellent timelines on history. It was someone that's called Towards Unity, with a slightly different viewpoint to my own, but obviously looking across the same sort of geographical and historiographic timescapes and landscapes. And this website is built around the economic geography, the anthropological geography, the political economy, and the sociology and history of well, what we term civilization, and it goes back 11,000 years to the first sedentary communities in the southern part of Turkey, northern part of Syria and Iraq, and traces the development of agriculture, commerce, means of exchange and trade through that time. And the theme of the novel is based around the current conflict in Syria. Now last summer I had hoped against hope that when Aleppo was liberated by the Syrian People's Army, President Assad's army, that would signal the end of what's been such a traumatic episode for the people of Syria. You know, above anything else, it's the ordinary citizens of Syria, many of whom I've met and got to know here in Sweden, because they've been refugees from this conflict. Sadly, that didn't happen, as we all know. There's been a kind of a bizarre repeat replay button where there's been a replay of allegation and counter allegation in the United Nations, etc. The plot of my novel remains unchanged. The Conquest of Doe, and with that, just in terms of navigating the website, there are various sort of slideshows and things which, if you you click on them, it will navigate through maps and detailed maps sort of showing different empires, a timeline of history going back to prehistory. And you can click on those and and they should get bigger. My internet's a bit slow at the moment, but why isn't that getting bigger? So here we are. Anyhow, I'm not going to click on things because that would just slow this video down and it will sort of go on and on. The Conquest of Doe, Epilogue and Chapter 1. Now that's on this tab here, which is the Novel and Epic Trilogy. And I published these on the website, the Epilogue and Chapters. This isn't working at the moment on my Ubuntu system here. It's an embedded joke book, a 2000-year-old Roman joke book, which is very funny. It does work on the blog. So, just by way of introduction, I'm Roger Lewis. I've been blogging since 2011, and I've been making YouTube videos since 2009. As I said earlier, I've almost finished my novel called The Plantsman, which is a satirical comedy novel about how we all have roles in our own lives that cast us variously as dramaticus personae, simultaneously or alternatively villain, lover, hero, simpleton or wise. My philosophy studies have led to a deep intrigue with plurality. Being more than one thing at once. These opposing and not always complementary roles we play make for some very funny situations, and it's these absurdities I wish to examine and shine upon the unself-knowing, pompous selves we all sometimes are. My second novel is informed by and informs the first, and I will not be able to finish it until novel two is completed. My second novel is called The Conquest of Doe, which is a metaphorical parable about sourdough bread and a legendary Syrian sourdough that smuggled to the UK. The Syrian refugee meets with challengers, helpers and enemies who seek to restore the dough to its homeland. Various actors wish the dough to be suppressed. Dough is the metaphor for money, which examines another of my areas of work, which is monetary reform activism. The finale of The Conquest of Doe is a hilarious romp through the Glastonbury Music Festival, examining the social aspects of that festival, parodying itself, whilst pretending it remains what it once was. If you remember last summer, Jeremy Corbyn spoke at Glastonbury. He figures, as does other well-known politicians, shall we say. It includes one scene of one well-known politician actually through a glory hole anally penetrating another politician. They're both sworn enemies, really don't like each other, apart from in that very bizarre situation. And this is all wrapped into something you can hear in a minute about control files and how people are blackmailed into doing things and what have you. And those two politicians figure in the debate in Parliament going back to 2013 when the British Parliament voted not to bomb Syria. That was when Obama was president, and therefore that limited the action that the United States were able then to take in destabilising the Syrian government. So it all sort of adds up. I mean, there are other funny episodes to do with Glastonbury as a cultural thing, and how that's changed over the years. And the middle bit of the novel is taken up with the journey between Syria, overland with detours, along trade routes, visiting different episodes in history along those trade routes with different sort of catastrophic or meaningful or influential events. So that's how the novel is all planned out, and how it, you know, how it goes from here. Dotted variously around the site are some of my poems as well. This one's called "Democracy Unfolded: The Emergent Reality of Brexit," which is at the bottom of this page. This trilogy of poems is about political economy. There are three of them which I wrote. One, "Usury Hell's Fuel, Man's Oppressor," which is a plain text poem which tells a story of monetary history, really. Another one's called "Bourgeois Resolution," which is a poem about peaceful resistance, civil disobedience, and how you know, successive revolutions that are violent repeats just repeat the mistakes of the past and end up with another tyranny. So "Bourgeois Resolution" is another poem. And then the third one in that trilogy is "Globalisation Unentangled," which is an experimental poem. And that poem is about globalisation and internationalism and how different ideologies get corrupted over time. And it visits contemporary things that have been happening in Europe, have happened pre-Second World War, pre-First World War. It's heavily influenced actually by H.G. Wells. The reason for that being, I decided during my research that it would be important to read the whole of H.G. Wells's non-fiction output, and a large part of his fictional output as well. It starts off where I write the poem, and then it morphs just into the notes. And the idea is that it's a grey space poem, an experimental poem examining Dadaism and Duchamp, Marcel Duchamp, and his famous saying about how the viewer makes the picture. I put together a little video of a section of a very, very good interview between Jeremy Paxman of by Jeremy Paxman of David Bowie, before Bowie died, of course. And it's an amazing video from, I think, 1999, about the internet. And it's vintage, sort of snooty nose, looking down his nose, Paxman, and his incredulity with respect to Bowie's feeling about the internet. If you watch it, you'll see that actually Bowie was actually spot on. But his reference to Duchamp and that really got me into Marcel Duchamp and the idea of the grey space. And that's another thing. Ready-mades was an idea that Duchamp had, where he took everyday items and made them into art pieces. I know a lot of people don't like modern or abstract art, modernist, you know, maybe they don't like Tracy Emin or something like that. I remember that house. I don't know if there used to be, or a sculpture up near the Mile End station. I think the LDDC paid for it, if not Tower Hamlets. And basically, it was a house going to be demolished, and it was basically turned into a cast in concrete by this artist whose name I forget. She also did, actually, incidentally, a cast of Room 101, the famous Room 101 from George Orwell's 1984, and of course, the television program with Paul Merton of "Have I Got News for You" fame. I digress. So, I have just put my output so far on this novel. Do click on the site, do register, and I'll keep you updated with how I'm going with my writing. There is a Patreon page, and which no one's subscribed to. I have a YouTube channel. I've got a thing called a WeTube channel. There's my WeTube channel, actually. I like WeTube. It's on the distributed web. I'm very interested in cryptocurrencies and distributed computing. There's a whirring in the background, which is actually my Ethereum cryptocurrency mining machine. This is WeTube, and these are the different things I've got on there. I haven't started paying a subscription. You can use it so you become convinced. I have become convinced, and I think I'm going to actually subscribe, because YouTube demonetized my channel in common with lots of other people's channels. I can still use it and do put things on it. But there's some poetry readings on here, some sort of films that are very hard to get hold of on YouTube because they keep banning the channels that host them. So various of my poetry. Je suis thought leader, that is a Dada-esque performance piece based on from my Duchamp period, as it were. There are four interviews on here with the author Roy Madron about his book Super Spark Democracy, is its published title now, but this is when he was writing the book, and I had the privilege of actually having a read of the drafts as they were going along. Alex Jones's outburst against President Trump. Seeing that Macron stuff today, I figured MAGA must stand for Macron. Macron's ass gets action from Trump. It was very crude, I know, but here's Boris at the United Nations. One of the characters you're going to hear about in a minute, it's not Boris, but it bears a striking resemblance to him. Boris's dad wrote a book, funnily enough, about Brexit last summer, which also had a character bearing a striking resemblance to his own son. But there we are. I guess if you've got a comic book persona, when people write satirical novels, you're going to kind of... Lytton Crosby... Well, I mean, do have a look. This is the video of the introduction to Globalization Unentangled. But anyway, that's my WeTube channel, which has got about 50 videos up on it. What have we got here? This is the YouTube channel, which is hosting Chapter 5. And finally, Distributed Web on Steemit today. And Steemit is the platform of the future for all you bloggers out there. You can earn Steem, and some people earn good money of Steem, and you can cash your Steemit into dollars or other cryptocurrencies and earn a revenue from your content. What is it? They've got a slogan which is quite funny. Proof of brain. That's right. The algorithms from cryptocurrency mining work on something called proof of work, and Ethereum is moving to something called proof of stake, but they call it proof of brain, i.e. you've used your brain, generated your content, and therefore people can do upvotes or make contributions in this cryptocurrency called Steem, which is convertible and ultimately convertible into regular currencies. As a monetary reformer, I'm very interested, obviously, in cryptocurrencies. So, without further ado, I've babbled on rather a lot, but having explained myself, with your indulgence, and I'm very, very pleased to have your attention. And if you've lasted this long, I hope this reading is not too disjointed. They are drafts, and so my punctuation, the fluency of this reading is not spot on, but of course it will be going through several drafts, copy editing, what have you. The dialogue will be properly syntaxed and all the rest of it. But hey, it's free, it's on the internet, if you like it, subscribe and what have you, and you'll have an opportunity to buy the finished article. But I'm now going to read the first four chapters, and I've already earlier recorded chapter 5, which I wrote this morning. So, The Conquest of Do, Epilogue, Chapter 1. The wise king said, "A word fitly spoken is like apples of gold in vessels of silver." Proverbs 25:11. Hear the explanation of what he said. The word maskioth, the Hebrew equivalent for vessels, denotes filigree network, i.e. things in which there are very small apertures, such as are frequently wrought by silversmiths. They're called in Hebrew maskioth, literal transspicuous, from the verb saka, he saw, a root which occurs also in the Targum of Ochelos, Gen 26:8, because the eye penetrates through them. Thus Solomon meant to say, just as apples of gold in silver filigree with small apertures, so is a word fitly spoken. My Ammonides, a guide for the perplexed. Epilogue, Chapter 1. As the low-hanging fruit rots, the true believers and credulous continued to grasp at the unseen upper branches of the tree of myth and ideology, clutching further and stretching longer, extending their reach by any means, even means unimaginable to anyone but the desperate and deluded. They knew that the golden apple no one had ever seen or produced evidence of its existence was there, just beyond their furthest reach, just out of sight of their keenest glance. So, as the low-hung fruit still rotted, having ripened and yet not nourished those for whom only the perfection of the golden fruit of pure ideological rarefied hubris would ever be enough. The obvious went ignored, its goodness rejected, in the pursuit of the impossible promises of soothsayers, priests, mountebanks, politicians, and Fifth Avenue suits and city bankers. So many lies clothed in so many promises, taking hope and optimism and producing a pathetic belief in the bounties of the noble lie. And here we see the autumn of a civil war where men, women, and children have perished, their death caused by what some in years to come will say was due to the mythical invasion of the sea peoples. Which historical turning of a 21st century ideologue would find its analogue in Aleppo, Syria? To the firestorms and privations of the Bronze Age collapse in 1150 BC. And what do these two disparate events and the low-hanging fruit and the apple of gold wrapped in filigree of silver have to do with our business here, in our thoughts and investigations in these coming pages? Search on, and we will surely find out and discover together as we look at the scenes that play out before us. Together we will, in our mind's eye, trace the steps of Hamed Abdul Hittit, the baker's son of Aleppo, he who was sent abroad again to seek refuge for the secret of his guild to be perpetuated in a bond millennia old and passed down from father to son. His story, along with the secrets of the precious alchemy from which his family had sustained Egyptian pharaohs through to the palace in Damascus of President Assad, a lineage that had served sultans, pashas, and great kings and queens of yore in the cradle of civilization. We travel through Damascus even before Abraham had spoken of God's word, already ancient when Jesus Christ was a boy, and older still when the prophet Muhammad received the Holy Quran. For Abdul's mission and secret recipe was the secret of Do, the sacred Do of Aleppo, from which all leavened bread had been exported as an idea and a method. Yet only the Hittite sourdough of the Hittite bakery of Aleppo was the true source and substance of the greatest, most sacred and honoured starter, the eminence and fountainhead of the baker's craft, tied to antiquity and bound to the most trusted and to a brotherhood of worldwide civilization. Where there was trade, there was counting to be done and accounts to be settled. Where farmers toiled and there were offers to treat, where merchants would seal their bargains with the breaking of bread and the dipping of bread in salt, and where the secrets of the alchemies of commerce were held deepest and closest, the Hittite bread would serve to mark the conquest of dough. Where all could bake and break bread, hewn from the earth of Mother Nature's bounty, the true source of the wealth of man in nature. Chapter 2, The Last Bakery in Aleppo. Abdul looks at the space where his father's head once sat upon his broad shoulders. The words his father had just spoke rung in his ears, and he held in his hands a jar covered in silver filigree, through which glistened the golden sheath, concealed and protected within. An ancient glass vessel held beneath a lid of fine ornamented bejewelled blue lapis lazuli, blue glass that shimmered as the Mediterranean Sea off the beaches of the Mediterranean. Within this sacred vessel was the most sacred of ceremonial doughs, the most secretly and jealously guarded of all Aleppo's secrets, more jealously protected down the generations of his family, more so than the Codex of Aleppo's central synagogue, the site of the cave of Elijah. This was history and the key to the sustenance of generations, a direct line back to before history began, a starter dough born of the first undomesticated grains and the yeast from the air breathed by the first civilizations of sedentary populations. These were the grains which formed the metrics for measurements from which the noble science of metrology sprang, the grains which defined the weights and measures of rations for the slaves of pharaohs, and the origin of all measurements from which all science and mathematics became codified. The grains that made this dough produced the sugars and the carbohydrates that nourished the bodies and fueled the thoughts of the mothers of all invention. In his hands, Abdul held a link back to the beginning of all that we know and all that we take for granted. And now it fell for him to take the holy sourdough to a safe place, far away over many seas and lands, to make good and redeem promises made long ago between contracting parties whose promises were sealed in blood and sacrifice and whose code had spread to the four corners of the world. Secrets now bleeding from the severed head of his father, yet locked still in the mind of his son, who stood momentarily shocked. He heard voices, the white helmets, the mercenary army of the black orders of usury, the challengers of the nobility of the dough. An interrogation, a blast of machine gun fire, screams, more interrogations. Abdul knew he must move fast, through the route known to his elite class of baker, to flee again the tumult that Aleppo had become, fleeing a war about monetary hegemony, and a war about vested interests in the monopoly supply of necessities. They were looking for what he held in his hands, the truth of man's wealth and debt to agriculture, and the universal access to and the production of bread. The white helmets were closing in. He knew he must say his goodbyes and hold on to his grieving for later, and hold on to the vessel in his hands even tighter. The freedom of good and the freedom of all men, of all the holy books, depended on his reaching the place of safety. Abdul knew he must retrace the route of civilization and trade and ensure that the dough of life be spread again to the four corners of humanity. For as the Middle East burned and as the powers of finance, capital and usury sought to extinguish the knowledge of dough, The Brotherhood of Bakers knew that as long as the idea of self-sufficiency and the breaking of freshly baked bread lived, the global domination of the means of sustenance and trade would always evade that black-hearted breed of man who would see orphans starve rather than yield control of the destinies of nations and relinquish their grip over an offence to the nobility of populations. He turned and ran. As the white helmet leader rounded the corner to the courtyard of the last bakery in Aleppo, so Abdul had vanished, as elusive as the fresh odour of newly baked bread invisibly seduces the senses, so Abdul had evaporated. The white helmet cried out, "Damn! There's the old guy! Where's the sun? Damn it!" He lifted the radio transmitter to his mouth. "White leader to carrier group 1, target on run. Mission failed. Advise telling Langley to alert drone strike force to seek and destroy. Repeat, target at large. Advise arm drones and seek and destroy civilians expendable. The target is at large." In a fit of rage, the white helmet turned and pointed his M17 at the corpse of Abdul's father, emptied the magazine in the still warm and not yet stiff corpse. "Damn you fucking rag-headed animal." A picture of democracy. Early one morning in the last bakery in Aleppo. This is where our story and Abdul's journey begins. Chapter 3, The Road to Damascus. Abdul, breathless and sweating, emerges from his escape route into Elijah's cave. A well-learned and never-forgotten routine has started to play out, told in songs and poems of the elders and forefathers, and now their sons of brothers, uncles and mothers and sisters play out, the rhythms and timbres of those ancient bonds, informing the protectors of the sacred dough what they must do and where they must go. Each link in that sacred chain knows the melody of this saddest and most solemn of songs, a song of flight, a song of terror, and a song of deeply bonded and grounded faith in the mutual respect of trades, crafts, and guilds, honouring credit and trust with mutual respect and protection. Elijah, son of Abraham, and grandson of Ezekiel, kisses the lapis lazuli's lid of the sacred vessel and embraces his brother in truth. "Brother, your father, he's dead, the white helmets came. You must hasten to Damascus, brother, this embrace will not be our last. I will take you to a guide, you must put on these clothes, and here are your papers. At Damascus, the guide will take you to your safe house, from where you will go on to Cairo." "Thank you, Elijah. How much time do we have?" "Oh, time enough, brother Abdul." The two men had often played as boys, a Hasidic Jew and a Muslim, along with Christian children of all faiths living in peace in this most ancient of playgrounds, now reduced to ruins. "Hey, Abdul, is Fatima and the children safe?" "Yes, they are safe, brother." "And Ruth and your boys?" "Yes, they are safe." And so the journey starts on the road to Damascus. Elijah and Abdul, dressed in black Orthodox garb, embark on the road to Damascus in a Red Cross Jeep, over rubble and through ruined streets and along that ancient road, both lost in memories and both reciting poems and humming those old songs which bind them to a common tradition, feared by these modern Caesars who now pursue them. "Drone control, Jake Brown," looks down at his remote monitoring scheme, which relays a picture from a drone 2,000 metres above the streets of Aleppo. He radios the white helmets. "Red Cross Jeep headed west, two men on board. Red Cross markings, are they clear for evacuation?" "Affirmative, Red Cross Jeep, Elijah Mordecai, Rabbi of East Aleppo, cleared to travel with assistant rabbi, fugitive just must still have gone to ground." And so our two fugitives follow the route of Samaritan fame to Damascus, perhaps some history for this leg of the journey. These Caesars that laid claim to the Mother Earth from which his family had grown out, from and were a part of bonds to Stonehenge, Scarpa Flow, Cairo, Alexandria, through to North Africa, Ethiopia, Libya, through the Greek islands and the Balkans, through Ukraine and the Urals routes, through which agriculture and commerce and trade had spread with no wars of conquest, until ideology and hubris has caused the striving for the true believers, zealots and credulous, to reach into unseen branches for mythological golden apples which had never been produced, and nor would they. This road to Damascus was a time machine of memories, and in those memories which bind all mankind in a brotherhood of common genesis, where the sense of self can be found if only one learns to look and see that common bond beyond the jealous ego of the jealous priesthood of conquests down the ages. Conversation between the two, which had naturally been limited until out in the countryside and headed away from the conflict area around Aleppo, but familiar place names reminded Abdul of old family stories of the curious visitor to Aleppo in the year 1812 by Sheikh Ibrahim ibn Abdallah, a Swiss traveller versed in Arabic and Mohammedan customs, which would later become famous as the first Westerner to see the fabled city of Petra in Jordan. This was an interesting and nostalgic time in many respects, the region then largely under Ottoman rule, in their inimitable delegating style with local pashas and sheikhs and various protectorates of colonial powers up and down the route, all providing a tapestry of the cultural, religious and ethnic geography up and down that famous route at that time. Dog-eared copies of the writings of the sheikh, his real identity was Johann Ludwig, also known as John Lewis, Jean-Louis Burkhart. His dates, 24th November 1784 to 15th of October 1817. Although the atmosphere was heavy with the grief of recent loss, the two were accustomed to death and loss and felt a close kinship to their long and distant histories, spanning cultures, ethnicities and other egotistical constructs that men fabricate to gain imagined status. That breed of man who justify unimaginable claims against territory and land, they have not and cannot ever know and feel as intimately as the indigenous peoples, who mould and blend into their surroundings. Abdul and Elijah knew a piece of heaven on earth, an affinity of shared horizons felt by all Aboriginals, in intimate rhythm with the harmony to the geography of their being. What a guy the sheikh was, Elijah. Here is a signpost to Hama. We are almost halfway now. The sheikh was fascinated by the tales of those motherfucking Ismailis and the Anzairs who have colonies in the East Indies. He said, you know, that he knew there were some Anzairis in the East Indies. They were greatly amazed at this and inquired how I had obtained my information, and the countenances seemed to indicate that there was some truth in my assertion. They're divided into different sects, of which nothing is known except the names, viz. Kelbi, Shamsi and Moklajai. Some are said to adore the sun and the stars, and others the pedendum Milbre, the Mokyedi wear in their girdle a small iron hook which they use when making water. It is also said that they prostrate themselves every morning before their naked mothers. Wait, slogans, fun. Asserted that they have a promiscuous intercourse with their females in a dark apartment every Friday night. But these are mere reports. It is a fact, however, that they entertain the curious belief that the soul ought to quit the dying person's body by the mouth, and they're extremely cautious against any accident which they imagine may prevent it from taking that road. For this reason, whenever the government of Ladakai or Tripoli condemns an Anzairi to death, his relations offer considerable sums that he may be impaled instead of hanged. I can vouch for the truth of this belief, which proves at least that they have some idea of a future state. It appears that there are Anzairis in Anatolia and at Constantinople. Some years since, a great man of this sect died in the mountains of Antioch, and the water with which his corpse had been washed was carefully put into bottles and sent to Constantinople and Asia Minor. We crossed the wadi at the foot of the mountain and continued along its right bank, on the slope of the mountain through orchards and fields till we arrived at the foot of the mountain upon which Kalat El Hosn is built. Our horses being rather fatigued, we sent them on to Djer de Jordas, the convent of St. George, where we intended to sleep, and walked up to the castle, which is distant 6 hours and a half from Chenin. It is built upon the top of an insulated hill which communicates on its western side only with the chain of mountains we have passed below the walls of the castle. Abdul had that passage by heart, as did Ishmael. Both had the stories handed down by oral tradition in songs and such feats of apparent super memory, lost to those in the West with short attention spans and even shorter tempers, can now but look on in awe at those painted as backward in the media of soundbites and distractions of the most inane trivia. The two fugitives, with their precious artifact of living, breathing memory back to the mists of time, would lay over for the night at the same castle which offered hospitality to the Swiss traveller who adopted Arab dress in his homeland, and later, when studying at Cambridge, he had been one of the later indoctrinates to the honorary fellowship of tradecraft bakers, who stood for a connection of peoples to their lands and reference wealth to the bounties of nature, and not the hard food of Midas currently rending asunder the lives of millions of Syrians. The journey back in time would continue to Damascus in the morning, and from there to Cairo and Alexandria. At the castle, we will look at the grains that make the measure and the cattle that form the holes that make the measure of a man and community support for its society. The story of the grains that still lend their name to the smaller weight measures of the gold those old and these new invaders seek to appropriate. Chapter 4. Grains of Truth. On these fertile mountain plains, fed by the springs and water wheels, the descendants of Abdul's forebears would have spread out from their Abu Huraya original settlement, where for 400 years ahead of the cultivation of crops, they became base for their hunter-gatherer society. Drought and climate changes in the middle Euphrates forced the hunter-gatherers to start cultivating. These early agricultural enterprises are found by the evidence of fat cultivated seeds, which are carbon radio dated to a 1,000-year dry spell known as the Younger Dryas, a period of cooling interrupting the gradual warming, which had begun already at the end of the last ice age. This was 11,000 to 10,000 BC. Much of northern Europe was still beneath retreating glaciers. The cereals from this era led to developments of the secrets of agriculture and metallurgy and invented the very first alphabet, religions, philosophies, the language of trade, systems of urban development, of diplomatic and cultural exchange. All these germinated in geographical Syria and led to the development of the dough which Abdul's family had been custodians of since time immemorial. Out of those first sedentary farming communities arose the units of measurement and value which remain familiar, although not understood in context, in the commerce of the 21st century. Between 3000 and 2000 BC we find the first written records of what society had evolved to from that distant step. Now submerged beneath Lake Assad and in the form of cuneiform tablets, we have the Code of Al-Harambi and the tablets of Ebla and Mari. The patron saint of translators, Saint Jerome, advised non verba ne verbo so sensum experimere de sens, the sense of the sense, with Latin irony, in which he meant to take from a text in one language the context of the writing, in how culturally and socially it would have been meant and heard by the writer and intended reader. This advice was quite possibly borrowed from, or by Jerome, from Cicero in De Oratore, the orator, when he said that in translating from Greek to Latin, I did not think I ought to count them out to the reader like coins, but to pay them by weight, as it were. And he is certainly not even coining the term word for word, but borrowing it from Cicero as well, or possibly from Horace, who warned the writer interested in retelling ancient tales in an original way, nec verbo verbum curabit redere fides interpretus, not to try to render them word for word like some faithful translator. Abdullah and Elijah had a common sense of meaning. They sensed in each other the bonds that the two had formed as boys. Also, they had inherited from generations before a bond to each other through the land. Theirs was a shared context with their conventional traditions and memories, predating even the faiths they now both nominally carried and which were designed to bind them to separate groups. Their bonds predated these religious categories by 11,000 years. They could never negate each other by such crude categorization. The area from which they were hewn was characterized by a rich mixture of farming opportunity, from the cereals to the buffalo, goats, and the dates. The surrounding areas had produced an abundance, which in turn led to the foundation and growth of the great ancient city of Aleppo, from where the two had just fled. There had been partings and disruptions before, until the written cuneiform records were rediscovered in the latter part of the 19th century and through to the present day. An oral tradition had carried the memories of their ancestors, the first farmers, even to the present day in folk songs, poems and dance and artistic artifacts and body decoration, each preserving the legends of previous wars, invasions, injustices and accountings for, and writings of wrongs, where they would stay for the night, looking across the valley towards the sea, across valleys towards Beirut, across Lebanon. These place names and peoples whose histories stemmed back to the period of the founding of Ebla and Mari between 3000 BC and 2000 BC, and their subsumption into the Akkadian Empire from Mesopotamia. The Akkadians were the source of the Semitic languages which both spoke, and out of which grew those languages of the Phoenicians, Aramaic, Hebrew and Arabic. Where they looked down into the valley to Lebanon, leading down into Israel, they knew there were seven species, now known as the seven species of the land of Israel, Shivatat Haminim, the two grains and five fruits, wheat, barley, grape, fig, pomegranates, olive and date, across the landscapes. Where they now travelled, it had become written in the landscape and the concentrations of population, what the land would support regarding population and the degree of sophistication and of luxury which had resulted in the lives of the people there. Along the rivers lay fertile stretches. On the Tigris and its tributaries and along the Euphrates there were river banks formed. Agriculture by irrigation generated bountiful harvests between parallel chains of hills, flatlands and narrow valleys, and higher ranges from the Piedmont plains along the Tigris to the alpine tops of the Zagros Mountains. Sufficient rainfall assured annual cereal crops and also produced an abundance of fruit trees. In the plains between those two great rivers, by the grace of weather and nature's whim, again there are areas where cereal crops of varying yields are nurtured by farmers to produce crops of varying degrees. Large tracts of land between sown fields and the barren deserts offer grazing grounds for flocks of sheep and goats, even for some cattle. Date palm plantations and horticulture, utilising the inundations similar to those famous on the Nile, are also harnessed. Gardens for vegetables and summer crops sustained by man-made irrigation, such as the water wheels, our two fugitives could hear stoically turning their watery nourishment, which mixed with sun and soil, as generations for millennia before had turned into food and wealth. Around areas of bonded kinship and cultural traditions formed natural and human topographies of localized and regionalized polities, societies, civilizations and cultures emerging from the potential of the combinations of nature's gifts harnessed by humankind. What the soils, rains, sunshine, winds and industry of farmers could coax from the land determined the development of livelihoods and community focal points, from where structures of family, community, society, hierarchy and faith developed. This is the grain of truth. From where Abdul and Elijah came, what made them, and from which all are made, all will flow from these agricultural species, those five, all this stemmed from Abdul and Elijah's ancestors in Abu Huraira 11,000 years ago. Abdul shouted into the valley, "Brothers, I will return to retrace our forebears' journey of truth and peace."